यस या डज एनीबडी रिमेम्बर
क्रोमोसोम।
क्रोमोसोम्स? ओके, एनी अदर रैंडम आइडियाज कमिंग अप इन योर माइंड?
जीन्स,
सॉरी, जीन्स.
जीन्स,
या जीन्स. देन व्हाट एल्स डिड वी लर्न? यू रिमेम्बर द नेम ऑफ द चैप्टर?
ह्यूमन बिहेवियर।
ह्यूमन बिहेवियर? या समथिंग ऑफ ह्यूमन बिहेवियर.
बेसिस ऑफ ह्यूमन बिहेवियर।
Of human behavior, yes. And which two bases are we learning in this chapter? Two bases. Engine out completely. Yes, Krishma, do you remember which two bases we are learning in this chapter? The third chapter. Yes, search, search. Textbooks, notebooks.
Biological basis,
surgical basis, and
cultural basis.
Cultural basis. So, before the exams, we finished the biological basis. I think we finished till the chromosomes and genes and that hereditary thing. And from today onwards, we'll be studying about the cultural basis of human behavior. So, let's start then. Again, what is culture? We have discussed about it too many times. What is culture? What is your idea of culture? Rather than the definition, what do you think is culture? Anybody?
Traditions, values, beliefs.
Yes, traditions, values, beliefs. Then what else? How do we form culture, or how are we part of a culture?
We practice them in our families,
yes.
Societies.
Yes. Then?
It is passed on from one generation to the other.
Sorry?
It is passed on from one generation to the next.
Can't hear you.
It is passed on from one generation to the
passed on from one generation to another, yes. Then? Do you think culture influences people, and more than that, people influence culture also? Yes or no? Who all thinks that people influence culture? Put your hands up. Nobody? Amar, are you scratching your head or are you putting your hands up?
Scratching head.
Okay. Yeah. How many of you think that people influence culture? Nobody? I'm not going to scold if it's a wrong answer. What, tell me what you feel. Do you think that humans also influence culture in turn? Yes. Anybody who thinks like that? Nobody. So only culture has influence on people, and people don't influence culture. You're all for that statement, right? Yes. Okay. So in the cultural basis, we'll be learning about the socio-cultural shaping of behavior. How the social and the cultural part around us shape our behavior, or how they influence our behavior, the basic human behavior. Now, who all are familiar with this? These three things. Anybody who hasn't seen these three things? Has not seen these three things? Nobody, thank God. Okay. What is common in these three things? Three things, sorry. Ashish. What is common?
Use.
Think common in these three things.
Use.
Use. What is it used for? Amal.
for eating purpose, like taking some food product, something.
For eating, for taking the food products. Okay. Meghna, have you used all the three?
No, only two.
Only two. Which one you haven't used?
Chopsticks.
Chopsticks. Okay. Anybody who has used chopsticks already? Anybody? No. Okay. Okay. Where do you think the people use chopsticks?
You mean the place?
Yeah, place.
Korea, China, all these places.
Okay, fine. And people in Kerala don't use chopsticks? Yes?
Well, it's not seen much.
Not seen much. But in Chinese restaurants, do we use chopsticks in Kerala?
In some places.
Okay. Again, the reason why I showed you these things is the three things, they have the same purpose. Basically, the same use. But the way we use it, the way we use it in different contexts, in different places, it's different, right? But the purpose is almost more or less the same. It is used for eating, right? So in our textbook, we have two examples given to explain the differences, the basic differences between animal behavior and human behavior. How culture comes into importance, how this culture shapes our human behavior, how it can be different from that of animal behavior in terms of culture. So the first one is hunger. In hunger, regarding animals, if we consider the lion and the small animals like deer in the forest, the lion is the predator and the deer is the prey. So the lion is not worried about his or her culture, where he or she is, or where it is living. What does the deer belong to, his or her distant family or not? It's not bothered about all these things, right? The lion just wants to finish off or cut off the drive, the hunger drive, or the hunger motivation in it. So the primary motivation that the lion will have is to cut off the hunger feeling in him or her. But in humans, the hunger thing is a very complex process. When you're very hungry and you don't get food, how would you react, Elvina?
You got very mad, like.
You would get mad, and how would you behave?
I would like more distress. Without having food.
Okay, and will you throw things at people?
No.
Is there anybody in our class who throws things at people when you're hungry and you don't get food? Yes, Amal, do you do that? No, ma'am. Okay. What other behaviors do you have when you are hungry and you don't get food? Anything other, different from that what Elvina told us?
Get angry.
You'll get angry. Yes. Then?
Tired.
Ashish, what do you do usually?
Go to kitchen.
Sorry?
Go to kitchen.
I can't hear you.
I will go to kitchen.
You'll go to kitchen and
open the
snacks box,
cupboards and everything.
Yeah. Some of the other thing will be there, right?
Yes.
Okay. So that is self-satisfactory reaction. He won't depend on anybody else, and he'll just go to the kitchen, get some food for himself. Okay. Any other reaction Amal, what do you do?
Same as what Ashish told.
Same as Ashish. Okay, very good. Boys are very calm and, you know, independent from everyone in our class. Meghna, what do you do usually?
Irritated.
You feel irritated then?
Then I will go to kitchen and check if it's something there. If not, I will make something.
Okay. You know cooking? Okay. Fine. Very good. Then, so, these reactions or these behaviors are totally different from that of an animal. Just like the example that we considered just now. The lion doesn't have a kitchen. The lion doesn't know to cook. The lion just knows to go after this prey and somehow hunt it down and eat it. And another thing, any vegetarians here? Aishwarya, okay. Then anybody else? Amal. Yes, Krishma, I can't see you, so I don't know if you're putting your hand up or not. Okay. Why are you guys vegetarians? Why don't you eat other food? I mean, non-vegetarian. Why?
That was actually a slow change for me. So, I started disliking non-veg. Suddenly, I became a veg.
Oh, you used to eat non-vegetarian earlier?
Yes.
What about you, Amal?
I just stopped eating non-veg.
When?
Ma'am, 2 or 3 years before.
Why?
Ma'am, killing other animals for food is not good, ma'am. I don't like it.
I can't hear you.
Ma'am, killing other animals for food, I don't like it, ma'am.
Oh, ahimsa.
It's a brute. It was brutal.
Yeah, sorry. I'm a non-vegetarian, so no comments. Okay, fine. Suppose if you were... who do we have? Yes, Elvina. If you were born into a typical Brahmin family, will you still be eating burgers and pizzas? Chicken burgers and pizzas?
No.
No, why?
Because
we
have born into that way.
Yes. So, again, it's the same thing with the related to the hunger and food, right? Again, the divisions come, the complexity comes, the vegetarian and non-vegetarian. We can tell that we also have vegetarians and non-vegetarians in animals. Then you can ask me the question, how is it different from animals? Because we have herbivores and carnivores and omnivores in the animal section, the whole animal section. But again, do they really choose? Do they go to hotels and restaurants and choose from the big menu that they have? No. And again, they can't go really go to a kitchen and cook. They can't set a campfire and have a grilled session there, right? So again, that is human behavior. This is a typical example, hunger, regarding hunger and food, the food habits and all. It is totally different from that of animal behavior. It is very complex in nature. Again, this particular hunger behavior or the food behavior, the food habits, all these things are influenced by the culture in which we are currently living in or the culture into which we were born into. Suppose if our family members, even if Elvina, again, even if you were not born into a Brahmin family, if your parents or your ancestors were typical vegetarians, then probably you would also try to follow that, right? And after you become a certain age, after you have your peer groups, after you have a certain friend circle, after you become independent of the family, then you would certainly change your choice, just like how Aishwarya not changed their choice of the food habits. Yes? Yes. What I'm trying to tell you is the culture in which we are born or the culture in which we are currently living in, it has a major influence on our behaviors. And one such example is hunger. And the second example given in our textbook is sexual behavior. Again, for animals, if we consider, they have a usual pattern of breeding. or engaging in sexual intercourse. But related to human beings have different methods, different features regarding the sexual behavior. Like one feature is partner preference. They can choose which partner they want or how many partner they want. Like religion. Religion is a part of culture, right? Religion is an essential part of culture. So in some religions, there is a rule or it is okay to marry more than two people. And in some cultures, it is even not allowed to marry. Okay? And some cultures, if we or if somebody loses the partner, then again, remarriage is not allowed. Again, complexity comes. It's completely different from that of the animal behavior. Animal behavior is the usual natural process of breeding takes place. But in related to the human beings, there are lots of changes, lots of values that are coming into play, lots of belief systems, lots of rules, lots of regulations that are coming into play when we consider the second example, that is the sexual behavior. And one feature of that is partner preference. The humans, they can choose which partner they have to have sexual intercourse with, or they can choose how many partners they have to have. They analyze, like in marriage also, in matrimony, we give so many features, right? Fair lady, tall lady, or a fair and handsome man of this particular age, of this particular height, of this particular build and all. Yes? Yes or no? Okay. Yeah. So we have so many complex features regarding sexual behavior also, which makes us totally different from the animal behaviors. Okay. So those are the two examples, hunger and sexual behavior. Now we move on to the concept of culture. Human behavior and socio-cultural context. That is a very, very common topic that we have studied so many times or that we have discussed so many times. Again, the same statement, that is human behavior is influenced by the social as well as the cultural context in which the individual is living. And it deals with the relationships, the reactions and engagements of people. Yeah. Relationship means... Yeah, relationships are formed after the interactions with people. One individual mingles with another individual or a group of individuals. Interactions take place. They talk. They undergo several conversations. They exchange their ideas. Then if somebody gives a particular statement, then the others react to it. So reactions form and they form several engagements. They form several associations, the friend circle form, the families form, and just like a circle or in a cyclic manner, the concept of culture develops. And the concept of this socio-cultural context also develops with these relationships, the reactions and engagements of people. Now, another important statement in our textbook is, although many other species are also social like us, human beings are cultural as well. So other species of animals, they are social like us. That is, they interact with each other. We have seen birds chirping with each other. Then monkeys, they might engage in some actions with each other. Or other animals also might be social, just like human beings. But what makes human beings different is the cultural fact. The culture, the tradition, that is a whole set of traditions, values, the belief systems, all these things are what makes the human behavior unique in nature. Although there are other species of animals that are social, just like human beings, the fact that we have a culture or we are part of a culture is what makes the real difference. What makes us unique from the other animals or species. Right. Then, again, in this statement, we told that human beings are cultural as well. So now we are going to see what it is meant to be cultural. In simple terms, culture refers to man-made part of the environment. Culture refers to the what part of environment? What part of environment, Ashish?
Man-made.
Okay, Aishwarya help you this time. Okay, man-made part of the environment. Diverse products of human behavior are the main focus of this cultural aspect. Diverse products of human behavior. What does that mean? What do you think that will be? Any idea? Meghna? What do you think? Diverse products of human behavior.
Relations, ideas, relations.
Yeah, that's particular words in that. But other than that, what do you think? In broader terms, what do you think they are? Diverse products of human behavior. There are human behaviors and after effects of that, or we can consider it as the byproduct of the human behaviors. I already told you, humans react, humans respond, humans behave, humans engage in different activities. So we have the total byproduct of these actions, reactions, response and all. And those byproducts, those diverse byproducts means the different byproducts that we get, those are the things that form the culture. And the products, some of them are included in these categories. That is, the first one is material objects. Then we have ideas. Then we have social institutions. Material objects, an example might be the room that you're in, the chair you're sitting, the fan, the electronic appliance. All these were put forward, or all those were made because of some human interactions, right? Humans might have, maybe somebody has, some ideas might have involved in some human mind that they need a shelter. And then some others might have thought about how to build a shelter. And yet another person might have thought about how you can put this into practice and really build. And yet another person might have actually builded the rooms. Yes, that's how it goes on. And ideas, we have different ideas on different concepts. Like just now we told about the marriage concept. Marriage is again an idea. Earlier, when we consider the early humans, the ancient people, they didn't have proper marriage, right? They were engaged, just like they were in the forest living with the animals itself. So they didn't have a certain concept like marriage. But now we have marriage, we have divorce, we have remarriage, we have extramarital affairs. We have so many diverse concepts. So again, the idea of marriage has also changed. So these are also the byproducts of the human interaction or the human engagements, the human reactions. Again, the other one is social institutions. Social institution means the family, the school. All those are social institution. Means it involves a social group. And it's also an institution. Like people, there is a group of people who is a part of society. And again, they also interact. They engage in different activities. Like in a family, we have different activities in a family. We interact with all the members in the family. Again, in the school, we have different type of, entirely different from that of a family. We have different activities there also. We have different levels of authority there. We have different group circles in the schools, different from family. So again, it depends on different institutions or social institutions. And these three things, that is the material objects, the ideas or social institution, these are some of the products of the human behavior. And it is also a part of our culture. And then, yeah, I already told you about the room that you're currently sitting. And the chair. Some of you might be sitting in a chair. Some of you might be sitting maybe on top of a table, maybe in the cot, or maybe in a revolving chair or something like that. Again, this also changes from culture to culture or from person to person. Now, there are some cultures where people don't know what a chair is. Like they sit on the floor. Haven't you seen people sitting on the floor? Yes. Yes. And again, if you mention the word chair, you can see so many diverse type of chairs like this. Again, this varies from place to place. Might be in certain areas inside the interiors, they have wooden works in certain places. So the chairs would also be made of wood. It's common. And in some other areas, that might be a very cold place where temperature is very low. So the chairs would have certain woolen equipments or woolen apparels to make the person comfortable. So again, that also depends on the cultural ideas of people. Again, the room that you're in, I already told you, the room that you're in, it might be of a rectangular shape or a probably a cuboidal shape, right? Yes? Any rooms other than these shapes? Any circular ones? No. Okay. Again, see this room. Do you know what this is called?
Igloo.
Igloo, yeah. Igloo, inside the interiors of igloo might be probably the top part would be a circular one or a curved surface inside, right? And again, their cultural values or their traditions, the Eskimos. I hope you know what an Eskimo is. People who live there, they are called Eskimos. So they have certain traditions and customs and all the climatic and weather conditions there. And based on that, they have built the igloos, which is entirely different from what we have here. Yes. So again, the cultural influence arises. And yes, I told you about that. So again, I'm bringing the statement which I asked you earlier. Human beings are not passive recipients of cultural forces, which means that culture not only influences people, but people also influence culture. It is from these interactions of these people that the culture is actually formed. If people don't interact with each other, if they don't engage in particular activities, if they don't respond to what others tell you, or if they don't react or respond in certain manner, then the culture as such would not be formed properly. It is from these interactions, it is from these conversations or from these engagements and associations that the culture is actually formed. And the earlier formed culture, they influence the coming generation and the current the people who are currently living in it. Okay? So, these are just general topics about culture. We'll stop here. Class is still 5, right?
Yes, ma'am.
We have already taken 3 minutes. Yeah. So, we'll learn the next portion in the next class. Any doubts till now? It's a very general topic, so go through the textbook. Okay? Okay. Do you have exams tomorrow? Which one is it?
Maths.
Wow. Very good. All the best.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, bye then.